Grand Prix of 1994. I'm Graham Smith, and I'm joined this weekend in the paddock by Tony Mason. Racing carts are simply stunningly quick pieces of machinery, whether they be driven by 8-year-olds or 50-year-olds. Let's see what it's like driving a 250.
I'm a real wild one. Wild one.
Wild one.
Wild one.
Wild one.
This is the hallowed pit lane at Silverstone. At a Formula One race, the place would be seething with people and high-tech machinery. But in karting, things are a little more compact. They may be compact, but they're still just as noisy.
One of the things about this sport is that drivers can start at a very early age. Cadets, what age did you start driving at?
Well, I'm not going to tell you because you might be able to work out how old I actually am, see. I actually started racing at about 14 because in those days, which was quite a long while ago, most of the drivers could only start at 14 because that was as young as you could be to start karting, the Mansells, the Sennas and so on. But today, of course, we have kids of 8 years old that start. And by the time they get to 10, 11, 12, which is 2 years before the Sennas and everyone else started racing, they are brilliant, absolutely brilliant. So what we're breeding from karting is we're breeding all the new Formula One champions of the future.
So the cadets roll out for the final, led by Nicky Richardson on number 2 and Daniel Welch on number 11. And they're off, led by Richardson, number 2. But Welch has drifted wide and he's over. He's hit the bales and turned over. Hodgetts was very lucky to continue. The 0 on Hodgetts' cart signifies he won the Open Championship last year. Back to the leaders, Richardson in front, Luke Hines second. That's Richardson in the lead. And they all pile round the little track that's been made out for these cadet carts. 60cc carts, clutch self-starter. Richardson still in the lead. Comes round behind the Armco, down past the start line. We just wait for him to re-emerge. And I think that's Luke Hines chasing him. Yes, it's Luke Hines on 42. And Luke's taken the lead. Luke's in the lead now from Richardson and Spencer. They come through the bales chicane, and it's a real ding-dong battle between these two. And Mike Spencer goes back into second, and here we are again. Richardson in the lead, Hines looking closely, and Hines goes up the inside. He's up the inside, and a tremendous move. He's into the lead. Hines is in the lead, followed by Richardson, then Mike Spencer. But Hines has clipped the bales, and he's lost it. He's thrown it away. And I think both of them will get past him. No, Hines is holding second, but the leader's got well away now. So we finish with a win for Nicky Richardson, Mike Spencer second, and Luke Hines in third. Stephen Hodgetts was fourth, followed by Andrew Delahunty, Matthew Granger and Andrew Twiss. Now the 250 national drivers make their way down to the dummy grid for the next race. Karting's very much a family sport. Everyone turns out to help father, brother or sister. And unlike the big motor racing events nowadays, nearly everyone stays at the circuit in tents, caravans or motorhomes. Let's have a word with one of the drivers.
I think essentially, you know, I'm probably of the opinion, well, you know, I'm too old to probably do anything else sort of at a competitive level anyway. So, you know, this offers a very, very cost-effective way of still, you know, getting a buzz, I suppose.
Yeah, let's have a look at the cart.
Well, what you've got your temperature gauge, you've got a digital tacho, and as I say, these are gearbox carts as opposed to the 100cc carts, which a lot of the young lads have sort of cut the teeth on. You've got your gear lever there, just by the side of the steering column. One interesting thing is that the rage at the moment in touring cars and stuff like that is sequential change gearboxes. Motorbike engines essentially have sequential change gearboxes.
They've all had them then.
Yeah. So all you do is to go up the box, you just push, and to come down the box, just pull it towards you. So we've been using these, you know, ever since you know, basically motorcycle engines have been on the go.
And how many gears?
The 250 single class, which is the one we're racing in, has got 5 gears. But some of your other classes have 6 gears as well. But it, you know, from a power to weight ratio point of view, I mean, these 250 singles will probably be pulling anywhere between 135, 140, even on the club straight here.
The most popular class this weekend is 250 National with 70 entries. They've had time practice and Chris Stoney came out top. But that's John Denton in the lead in heat one. And Mark Allen's put his hand up. Wonder why that was. But Denton seems to be well away here. John Denton coming around Loughfield 2 into Woodcote. Chased hard. That's Chris Stoney. Mark Allen's still going though. John Denton in the lead, round Cobbs. Simon Babington's chasing him. And that's Howard Spooner. He's getting out of his abandoned car, just on the start line. Down they come again to Brooklands. It's John Denton in the lead. Chris Stoney dives down the inside of Simon Babington and takes second place, and that's Andy Martin in fourth. But John Denton looks to have this one in the bag. Comes round, takes the checkered flag. John Denton followed by Chris Stoney and Simon Babington. Stephen Palmer went straight on at Brooklands. Looks like he went full tilt into the barrier, but he's all right. They're clearing him up. In any of the particularly dangerous places, straw bales are put out. And the marshals are clearing away the broken carts. These 250cc single-engine two-stroke carts put out around 65 brake horsepower. Let's see what Andy Taylor says.
This is a bit of a worry, isn't it? The engine up before the race.
This is the third one so far.
What, this weekend?
Yeah. I've had 2 seizures and a clutch go so far. So it's not been a brilliant weekend for me.
Carts are started by a push from behind until the engine fires and off they go in a cloud of blue smoke. Now heat 2. Again, Denton up the front. They're led round by a pace car for a lap and then they creep up to the start line as the pace car pulls off. And they're just waiting here for the red light to go green. Creeping to the line and then feet down. And the plunge down into Cops Corner. Denton again has taken the lead. Someone's gone wide, but he recovers, and the pack streams past. That's John Denton in the lead. He's got a good lead now. Number 22, Adam Wilcox, has been going well in this race. But John Denton wins again. Richard Boston takes third. And there's even enough time for the marshals to have some sport of their own between races. But now the pack's thundering down to Cup's Corner for Heat 3. Mark Allen it is this time. He dives out into the lead. Round Cop's. But some of the midfield runners have come off. Goodness, the track's blocked. Surely this will mean a red flag. The marshals will do their best to clear up. But there's two or three carts there, right in the middle of the track. Can they get it clear before the carts come round on the next lap? And it's Allen in the lead, on the way up to Maggots. Stoney in second place. And Allen really looks to have this one going well this time. Somebody spun. That was Phil Martindale. But back to Cops. And I don't think they're going to get that track clear. They're trying their best. They're getting the carts off the gravel. But no, the red flags are out. The red flags are out. The carts will stop racing and they'll head back round to the paddock.
Five different compounds that we use, ranging from super soft to really, really hard. It all depends on the weather.
How well do you know Silverstone?
This is about the fifth year I've done Silverstone now, and of course, as you know yourself, they keep changing the circuit every year, and it doesn't help. It doesn't help at all.
So you've had to relearn it for this year then?
Yes, we have, yeah. Cop's very, very tight now, a lot tighter than it has been, and it causes a few problems. So we shall learn by the end of the day.
So, Mark, you'll be hoping that the British Grand Prix is a bit kinder to you than last year. What happened?
Well, last year we had a couple of reasonable finishes in the heat. Come the final, it was stopped after an incident into the first corner. Restarted. We had a good dice, 75% of the race. Just into the last three laps, I did ease away a fraction. I came into Brooklands, lifted off, and the spark plug ceramic blew out. That was it. Stood and watched the other couple of laps. It was exciting to watch, but a bit disappointing. So.
Not what you wanted.
No, hoping for better things this weekend.
That was Mark Allen. Remember, he was leading Heat 3 when it was red flagged, and now Heat 3 gets back underway, and the carts come down to Cops for a retry. But Mark Allen hasn't made such a good start this time. Chris Stoney takes command as they come round Cops. Head up to Beckett's. And we watch for the carts coming over the brow of the hill, up towards Maggot's Corner into Beckett's. Mark Allen dives out to have a look, but something's gone wrong with his cart. I think he's got a puncture. And it's dead in the lead, and Mark Allen slides straight across the front of the pack. He was very lucky nobody collected him. So on the road down to Brooklands this time, that's Mark Allen. Pushing the cart out of the way. I think he's got a rear tyre come off, or a rear puncture. Chris Stoney in the lead. Down to Brooklands. So it's Stoney. Another three carts still in touch with him. But he seems to have a good lead now. Round Loughfield 1, Loughfield 2, Woodcut. And we're down to start-finish line. John Denton goes into second place. Stoney well ahead, and he's seized. Stoney's seized at about 130 miles an hour. He was very lucky to have been so far ahead. If he'd spun in front of the pack, there could have been a disaster there. And he'll just pull off to the side now. That's Stoney's heat run. That will really set Chris Stoney back on the grid for the pre-final. And now back with the leaders, and it's Andy Martin in front now. Andy Martin on cart 65, followed by Simon Bolton and Stephen Webb. So Andy Martin just holding the lead, and they're about to come up to the checkered flag, and they cross the line virtually together. Andy Martin wins just from Simon Bolton and Stephen Webb.
Tell us what happened there.
Yeah, basically I've seized twice now in 2 days for, I think it's because of the heat, and I'm running too fine a needle. So that's my race over, maybe my race day over. I'll have to get a new piston and see if I can sort it out.
But you'll come back for more?
But I'll come back for more, yeah, definitely.
So Mark Allen and Howard Spooner's carts are taken back to the paddock. Let's talk to one of the drivers, Steve McAdam from Ulster.
Through it here.
Yeah, well, this is a Jaed chassis and a KTM, an Austrian engine, and it's last year's cart, really, but we've got the bodywork on it for to help with the aerodynamics, you know. We can play about with the wings there for more downforce in the rear, and we can move the fronts in and out there to get a bit more grip at the front. And it really is quite streamlined, you know. You have to, you're always looking for wee bits here and there to get a tenth here and a tenth there, you know. No, you can use a 250 National. There's quite a lot of choice. Yamaha, Suzuki, KTM, Honda, Rotax now has just come in. So there's quite a number of engines that you can use, and different guys use different engines. There's something like 70 competitors in our class this weekend, and it's the biggest entry of all the classes, and they're all using a variety of engines.
So the heat results put John Denton on pole for the pre-final, joined on the front row by Andy Martin on 65, Richard Boston on 74, and young Adam Wilcox on number 22. Chris Stoney's way back on grid 25, and Stephen Webb's behind him. Mark Allen's on grid 31 for this 10-lap pre-final. There's 60 carts on this grid, 250cc single-cylinder engines, mostly Rotax, KTM, Yamaha or Hondas, pushing out about 65 brake horsepower. They have 5 gears. The pace car leads them round. The drivers are weaving to warm up their tyres, get them as warm as possible before they go racing. They're not allowed to weave too much. So there'll be about 10 carts to maybe 20 carts that won't have got into this pre-final. They won't have had good enough heat results, so they'll be nearly 60 carts on the grid. The pace car pulls off. The drivers look sideways to see if they're all in line, see if the starter's happy as they come up to the line. Eyes glued to the start lights, right feet poised over the throttle pedals, looking for the green light. And away they go. Sixty carts thundering down to Cops Corner. Plenty gravel here to catch the unwary. And, in fact, Tony Whitter has spun. Nigel Puddypat collects him, but he tries to keep going. And Mark Allen spun, but he should get out. Tim Waters is in the gravel. He needs a push. Phil Martindale spun again. David Maxim also, and Peter Cook all spun, while many more had to take avoiding action. But the race continues. That's Andy Martin, and oh, he's in trouble. Andy Martin's lost quite a lot of places there. He got a little bit sideways, and that set him well back now in the pre-final. And it's Adam Wilcox in the lead, young Adam Wilcox, who hopes to go into Formula Renault next year. And round he comes, Wilcox in the lead. And the whole pack thunders past Woodcut and down into Cox Corner. Still Wilcox leading the pack down into Brooklands. He's got a very good lead as he goes round into Loughfield 1. The others chasing rather vainly, but he's slowing down. Wilcox is in trouble. He's slowed. I think he must have seized. He's obviously got some trouble there, and he's out, so he'll be right at the back for the final. What a shame for young Adam Wilcox. And that lets Richard Boston, number 74, into the lead. And here they come again, but it's Stephen Webb. Stephen Webb down the inside at Brooklands, snatches the lead from Boston. And it's Stephen Webb heading for a win, then Richard Boston and Chris Stoney. Now he's got past Lee Gage.
Stuart, you're fifth on the grid for tomorrow's Grand Prix now. Are you happy with that?
No, I'm a little disappointed. We had a bit of an incident on the first lap of practice this morning, so unfortunately I just managed to kiss the wall on the pit lane, so I had a bit of problems with the handling this morning.
Why did you do that? Were you involved with anybody else?
Well, I don't know what really happened. I was coming up the straight. It was the first lap of practice, and I looked up and there were four carts spinning in the middle of the circuit, which I really didn't expect, so I'm not sure what happened, but I just spun to avoid Peri Gronstra.
Now, you've been British champion, but you do spend most of your time in France at the moment. Why is that?
Well, it's partly to do with Kodak sponsorship. They wanted me to race in France, and the French championship's very healthy, like the British championship, and it was nice to go and do some new circuits, so it was very interesting. We've been having a good time.
What sort of a following does karting get in France? Different to here?
Yeah, very different to here. They do something very different. In France, karting, the supercarts, support things like the superbike championships. Mm. So we race at the same time as the superbikes. So we get some very, very big crowds, 30, 40,000 people. It's very exciting.
Now, what do you think of this circuit?
Oh, this is my sixth or seventh year on the trot at Silverstone, and the atmosphere at Silverstone has always been fantastic. I mean, it really is the British race of the year here, so it's fantastic. COPS is a little different this year, of course, because they've changed that to make it safer. But still, I love the circuit, love the atmosphere.
Presumably, the Cops Corner was altered for car racing, really. Does it make it safer or better for karting?
Well, I think if it's going to be safer for Formula One, whose speeds and the energy they've got is much higher, it's going to be even safer for karting. It just slows down the corner, but it's the same for everyone. You've got to drive around the corner, so it doesn't make the racing any different.
Three times world champion Martin Hines, top time practice with a 58.5 second lap. An average speed of 101 miles an hour. Peri Gronstra from the Netherlands was second, 58.59, and Simon Cullen was next in the grid. Stuart Mead fifth. But Gronstra swoops into the lead at Brooklands, followed by Simon Cullen, Trevor Roberts and Martin Hines. And Cullen pulls out. Cops, it's Simon Cullen, followed by Peri Gronstra, Trevor Roberts, and a slightly down in power Martin Hines. So at the flag, it's Cullen, Gronstra and Hines. Now this is an international field with Netherlands, Sweden, New Zealand and Australia all represented here at Silverstone.
So, Jerry, you're the Australian kart champion. What do you think of this track here?
Silverstone, this is the third time I've been to Silverstone, very nice circuit. It's wide open, a lot of fast corners, a bit similar to like Phillip Island back home in Australia and also Eastern Creek, so where the 500cc bikes race.
So there is a difference between the carts in Australia and the ones here, really?
No, the carts are the same. We run the same carts, but the thing is, out here they run something like Killgate brakes and they run computer systems on the cart, which make them, give them all telemetry sort of detail of what it actually is and isn't going wrong, same as Formula Ones.
How popular is karting in Australia?
Very popular now. At the moment in Australia, the 250 classes, we'd get a field of, say, 30 around Australia for the Australian Championships, which is good.
Yeah. So, obviously, you're here and you've come a hell of a long way to do it. Do you go around the world karting all the time?
No, not last year. The year before I did, we did the World Championship, which is Barbara Hepworth and Dave Hepworth, our team manager, and myself and my wife. But yeah, we like to come overseas and race and see what the people have done over here and then go back home. And really back home, we're the best in the country, Barb and I, and we beat them by half a lap. and it's really, you know, to come here to get a bit more experience is better. So that's what we'd like to do.
Barbara, are you enjoying it?
Oh yes, I love Silverstone, although the new corner at Copse is a bit different to the last one, but I just love the place.
So how many times have you been here to drive?
I think this is my fifth time. We came in 88, 89, 91, 92, oh yes, 94, so yes.
So you're not only one of the few Australians here, but also one of the few lady drivers. Why is that?
I don't know. I've been racing for a long time now, and I don't know why other ladies don't take it up. They should. We've got a lady coming on in Australia. She's in the 80cc class, and she's had a drive of my cart. And when I retire, I think we might put her in. It's got to have a lady driver out there somewhere.
Why do you think there aren't more of them here?
I don't know. I think perhaps there's a few males around that don't really like not understanding husbands like I've got.
So what do you think of the field that you're driving in here?
It's a very good field. It's very close. It's a lot harder than we race in Australia, and it's taken me a little while to get into it, but with a bit of luck, we'll go well.
What about the speeds here at Silverstone?
Very similar, perhaps a little bit faster than at home, but about the same. I mean, you can only get the maximum out of every engine, and they go through the corners a lot quicker here because the competition's always a lot harder. So we take a little while to catch up with them.
Martin Hines waits on the grid for heat number two. Remember, he was only third in the first heat, so he'll be really trying hard this time. He's consulting with his race engineer, that's Grant Munro. He's from Australia as well. These supercars could do 160 miles an hour at some of the motor racing tracks. They are tremendously fast cars. And they're just getting ready to push out for heat two, the Formula E supercars. And off they go, heat two. Down to Copse. And it's kart number three, Simon Cullen in the lead, just ahead of Hines. Grunstra takes up third place. Down to Brooklands, Cullen in the lead, but Hines dives down the inside, takes the lead. Round Lafield one, Hines, Cullen. So it's Hines, Cullen, Roberts, Grunstra, Stuart Mead. Round Copse they go. Hines still in the lead. Looks to be going a lot better this time. And it's a win for Hines. Motor well sorted, followed by Cullen, Trevor Roberts, Grunstra, Mead and Alan Pritchard. Let's see what Martin thinks of the track.
What about the modifications? Copse has been altered, the corner there. What do you think of that?
Well, I'm just trying to think how I can put this politely. Copse, I think, I used to think it was a wonderful corner, and I appreciate the reasons that it had to be changed to slow down cars and obviously the event of serious accidents to prevent them. But it, to me, it just takes a little bit of the flow out of the circuit. Although saying that, as we're getting more and more used to it, it's quite a demanding corner, and once you get it dead right, and you can get through there sort of about 110 or so in a kart, it's quite exciting to get through at 110, because I've nearly cracked this.
So with Simon Cullen having earned pole position for the Formula E pre-final, alongside Hines, Grunstra and Stuart Mead, they're off again for a 10-lap pre-final over 16 miles. And it's Hines again, no nonsense, straight into the lead. Hines followed by Gronstra, Cullen. And the whole pack coming round Beckett. That's 18, Paul Pedalti. Taking up the tail end, but Hines in the lead. Hines, Gronstra and Cullen battling out for second place. Cullen's gone into second. Chasing hard after Martin Hines. Gronstra third, Trevor Roberts fourth. Oh, goodness. That's Duncan Lomax, he had a real tank slapper, and Roger Mayers did a quick spin, but he seems to be continuing. So Martin Hines, still in the lead, he's not got very far ahead though, but looks well on track to take the checkered flag. Almost a second ahead of Simon Cullen, then quite a bit longer gap to Perry Gronstra and Trevor Roberts. So Hines wins, Cullen, Gronstra and Roberts.
Do all the drivers do their own mechanicking work in this game?
Most of them, except for the front runners. Most of them are sponsored, you know, so they've got the guys to do their own. They've got their own mechanics and laptop computers, you know, and all that sort of thing.
Now it's nearly time for the first of the Grand Prix finals. The first one is for 125 National, single-cylinder, air-cooled engines, mostly rotary valve engines, giving around 30-plus brake horsepower. Now watch out for number 14, Graham Barker. He won both heats, but he went out on the second lap of the pre-final, so he starts at the back in company with other well-known drivers like Nigel Wigg, who topped Pine Practice, and Malcolm Clark. Most of these 125s use a full bodywork. Paul Wilkinson's on pole in the number one car, Nick Padley on number four, Andrew Serby number 12, and Kevin Clark on number six. And here they come, watching for the green light. The first final. Wilkinson's hit the front. Yep, it's Wilkinson. I just watch out. Watch for that number 14 cart of Graham Barker up from the back of the grid already. So it's Wilkinson, Padley, Graham Barker, Keith Davis. Someone spun. Got Paul Wilkinson in the lead now. Paul Wilkinson followed by Nick Padley. So it's Wilkinson, Padley coming down to the start line. Roundward cut. Wilkinson in the lead. No, Padley's taking it. Padley's in the lead. Wilkinson's still second. And they head up to Maggots. Padley in the lead. Wilkinson looking up the inside and he's got it. He's taken the lead again. Down into Brooklands. Wilkinson in the lead. Padley second. Graham Barker third. And Keith Davis is fourth. Already we've lost four carts. And Graham Barker got a fastest lap of 66.42 seconds. So So it's Graham Barker in the lead now. No, Padley back in the lead at Copps. Padley in the lead, Wilkinson second. So Padley, Wilkinson, Barker. Down to Brooklands again. Padley, Wilkinson. No, they're all three together. Someone's locked up a wheel. So Graham Barker in the lead now. Graham Barker leads down to Copps. Who will it be this time? They're all jockeying for position. And Wilkinson's gone wide. Wilkinson's gone wide at Copps, but he's recovered. He's lost a few places. He's out of contention for the lead now, I think. And they head up to Beckett. What a battle this is. Four, 14-11. That's Padley, Barker, Keith Davis. Graham Barker in the lead at Brooklands. Nick Padley in second, pressing him hard. And we're back to Brooklands again. Still Graham Barker in the lead. Keith Davis dives into second place. Can he hold it round Loughfield? So it's Barker, Davis, and Keith Davis goes into the lead this time at Copps. Again, jockeying for position. Three abreast almost as they come into Brooklands. Different lines round Woodcote. Slingshot effect. Dive out of the slipstream. The lapboards go out from the pit crews. Round Copps. Graham Barker ahead. Heading up again to Beckett's. This is quite a fight, this. A really tremendous battle amongst these 125 national carts. And this, I think, must be the last lap, and there's a back marker ahead, and that could cause Graham Barker a problem. Yes, he's lost momentum. Graham Barker has lost momentum with that back marker. He's not very pleased at all. The others have caught him up, but he's still ahead. Takes a tight line into Brooklands, round into Loughfield, and Padley's alongside him as he goes round Loughfield 1. And Barker spun. This is incredible. Barker just lost it there on the last corner as the checkered flag comes out. Let's just look at that again. Here they come. Down to Brooklands. Barker protects his line and Padley goes round on a different line to try and sweep past on the other side. Did they touch? I don't think so. I think Padley just nosed past and Barker just lost it on the outside. Terrible bad luck. He's so disgusted. So Padley wins. Keith Davison and Anderson Minarelli, then Paul Wilkinson on a similar cart third. Kevin Clark just behind on his Anderson with Rotax Power. David Tin fifth on a Zip with Rotax Power. Only 10 finished this race. The same again, none finishing. And the marshals go to rescue Graham Barker's stricken cart. The 210 class now, the oldest gearbox class in karting, using the Villiers 197cc or replica engines.
It all seems very gentle and everything, the pace. I mean, isn't there any panic on? You've got to get it.
There is when you get going and it ain't running, Roy. There's plenty of panic on.
This is a class Nigel Mansell used to race and win regularly in. The carts come up to the start, watching for the green light. 35 on the grid this year. A good turnout for these 197cc carts. And they don't have quite such fast acceleration as the newer classes as they come down to Copps. and on the way up to Beckett, and it's Chris Cattermole, that's last year's winner, number one in front. Lionel Sifflate, number 19, is pushed his way through to second, and Bill Tully on number 30, he's come out of retirement to work to drive the Works Invader. Went a little wide, but he's still in there. And Egon Ashwell retires, a disastrous day for him after an earlier heat win. Now it's Sifflate, 19, Cattermole 1 in second place. And Cattermole's gone wide on his jade. So it's Andrew Ayres now in the lead, number 18. Kelvin Benarski second with a great pile of cars. Benarski won the other heat. This is a tremendous dice for the two tens. It's so close you could throw a blanket over the first half dozen carts. We really are seeing some tremendous racing here at Silverstone this afternoon. So it's Ayres in the lead. Bill Tully pressing him hard as they come round Widcott. They're so close. Tully's obviously in the slipstream, ready to dive out. But no, not this time. I think he's just going to hold position round Copse. That's Dave Brown retiring. And Sifflate's gone as well. So we've got Ayres, Tully and Benarski. That's Kelvin Benarski on his Anderson. Passing a back marker. And now Benarski into the lead. Benarski in the lead at Copse. Benarski, Ayres, Tully, all three, it could be any of them still. Quite a tremendous race. Tully slingshots out, but no, not this time. Didn't quite work. I just can't believe how close these carts are. Bill Tully on 30, third place. Benarski in the lead, followed by Ayres and Tully. And Tully into second now. Again, coming up on a back marker. I think that back marker must be going very slow. I haven't seen him before. Different lines round there. So Benarski in the lead on the very last lap. Quite a fight still for second place. But Benarski is going to take the Grand Prix. Coming up to the checkered flag. Benarski wins the Grand Prix for 210 National for the third time in a row. His Anderson's clearly going well. Bill Tully next on the Invader. And Benarski's very, very pleased. Bill Tully's gone wide.